What is happening? Oh. Hanging out on the corner. You never know who this is. Well, good afternoon, and thanks for joining all of us to welcome Sidney Kimmel and Caroline Kimmel here to the Kimmel Cancer Center. And one of the things that we thought we might do today considering the tremendous impact that Sidney's philanthropy has had, by the way, not just here, but throughout all of cancer. He's the single greatest philanthropist in the entire field of cancer, whether it comes from chairing the March on Washington that led to a doubling of the NIH budget. We could certainly use that kind of logic again. We need to recreate that effort that he was able to deliver for us. That's worth an applause, actually. Right there. To significant gifts to great institutions in Philadelphia, here in Baltimore, out in the West Coast, and to one of the things that I know that he and Caroline are very proud of, which is the Kimmel Scholars Program, which has been of great benefit throughout the country, really funding the best in young talent entering the cancer research field, giving them the opportunities they need to build careers, to change the world. And you'll be able to see that it's changing right here in Baltimore. There's a number of Kimmel Scholars here. We get to have a photograph with a few of them. You'll hear from a few of them this morning. And so what we thought we would do at the beginning for a brief time is to look not back at what has been accomplished, but in fact look forward. Now that we've gotten to where we've gotten in the world of cancer research and cancer medicine, I think everyone has a sense that things are getting better and better. New treatments are arriving, new ways to diagnose and detect cancers at early stages. All these things are happening with an increasing momentum. It enables you to look into the future a little more accurately. And I think what we have is a group of people with a variety of different perspectives, ranging from different medical disciplines, different scientific research approaches, population science down to cell biology. And what we thought is we'd have each one of them introduce themselves, give a very brief view of how they see the world evolving and emerging in the coming years, and then a little bit of back and forth, and then we have a very special treat for you after we're done. So why don't we start at the end, actually, with Laura Wood. We need to start with Laura because in case she has a funny look on her face, we may need to take maneuvers quickly. But Laura is a Kimmel Scholar and a
great one. I guess I should be in an OB talk, right? Be more prepared just in case. You know, when I talk to I have a lot of non-physicians in my family. They always ask me, when are we going to find the cure to cancer? And I always feel bad because I don't want to say there is no cure to cancer. But I think what the way to treat cancer is going to be is you divide it up into smaller and smaller subsets that are responsive to specific treatments. So there's no one treatment that's going to help everybody. But instead, what we need to get better at as physicians and scientists is figuring out who's going to respond to what therapy. And I do GI, and there are a couple of nice examples of that. So patients with pancreatic cancer who have a defect in their DNA repair respond to specific chemotherapies. Patients with colon cancer that have a different defect in their DNA repair respond to immunotherapies. And so we're just kind of whittling away and getting these small subsets of patients who respond to specific therapies. And in that way, we'll never have one cure to cancer, but what we'll find is that we'll find cures for individual patients.
So as you've heard from Laura, you can think of cancers as many diseases, of course, as many diseases. Of course, what this is a follow-up on is something really pioneered in many ways here, and that is all cancers are fundamentally disorders of acquired defects in genes and in gene function. And as we've begun to more completely characterize these, some of the work, as you all know, done, Bert Vogelsang, Ken Kinzer, the Ludwig group, what we've begun to learn is some of the things that go wrong in cancer cells, but we still need to figure out exactly how these things work. How did the cancer genome become corrupted? What's the consequence? And another Kimmel scholar that we'll hear from, Andrew Holland, is really a cell biologist who can tell us what went wrong. What's wrong in a cancer cell? How does it get that way?
So my name's Andrew Holland. I'm an assistant professor in molecular biology and genetics. And my lab is fundamentally interested in cell division. And cancer, after all, is simply dysregulated cell growth. And there's been a number of important drugs that we use today in the clinic that target the cell division apparatus. One such drug would be paclitaxel, which is a blockbuster chemotherapeutic, one of the best-selling chemotherapies of all time. And although this is an incredibly useful drug in our arsenal for attacking cancer cells, it's not without its drawbacks, because like many of the drugs that we use in the clinic, paclitaxel does not discriminate the divisions of tumor cells from the divisions of normal cells. And so patients that are treated with these drugs get toxic side effects that arise because of the fact that these drugs also kill normal, healthy proliferating cells of our body. And so I think it's very clear that in the future, we have to understand more about the molecular differences between how normal cells and cancer cells divide. And we'd like to be able to develop therapies that are more specific, that would be able to target the divisions of tumor cells whilst leaving those normal cells untouched.
So, of course, normal cells are collected into organs. Organs together, when working in concert, form bodies, human beings. But we can also consider cancer on a population scale. It's becoming the largest cause of death for human beings on the planet Earth. And thinking about cancer at that scale, we can begin to think not just about what went wrong in an individual cell or what type of cancer is an individual person, but how do we help whole populations of people with cancer? What kind of interventions? How do you see that working in the future? It's Elizabeth Platts. I'm sorry, I didn't say
your name. Hi there, I'm Elizabeth Platts. I'm a professor of epidemiology at the School of Public Health here and also here at the Cancer Center. So I am an epidemiologist. I study whole populations of people at a time to identify risk factors that we can intervene on to reduce the risk of individuals being diagnosed with cancer, developing the disease, and being diagnosed with that series of diseases, but also to figure out if we have cancer patients as a population, are there ways we can intervene beyond treatment to prevent poor outcomes in those individuals? And so what we try to do now is to identify, are there subsets of people who could benefit more from some preventive strategies than from others? It's very difficult, for example, to get people to quit smoking. But we try to figure out, are there subsets of people who, for whom one strategy would work better than another? Other areas of the future are to understand better the biology underlying our risk factors. If we can understand the biology, we might be able to figure out better points for prevention, for intervention, both for those who don't yet have the disease and in those who do have cancer. So you may not realize that smoking is a risk factor for poor outcomes in patients who already have cancer. That's the type of research we want to be able to do to inform how to have better outcomes in patients in addition to treatment. The other thing that I think is important for the future is to be able to use patient populations, use big data, to be able to identify what may work the best in certain clinical settings than in other settings. And I don't just mean, again, for treatment, but also for prevention services.
So you hinted that there may be differences in people who start smoking from people who don't and people who find it difficult to stop. Have you figured out what it is that drives some people's urge to eat kale and the other's inability to do so? It's a private joke between Sidney and I.
So, of course, we have genetics, right? So genetics may dictate whether or not you find, for example, cilantro pleasing or not, right?
That's right.
So everyone knows that cilantro example, right? For some people, it tastes like soap. And for others, it's a very pleasant taste. And so genetics actually can dictate whether or not you become very addicted to nicotine, for example, versus not, whether you have an ability to quit smoking or not. So understanding genetics actually will inform prevention strategies going forward.
So next, with Chuck Drake, there's been a rumor circulated in our field that the immune system is capable of recognizing cancers and destroying them if properly tasked. Is that true?
Fortunately so.
So how do you see the world unfolding?
So I'm Chuck Drake. I'm a professor of immunology, oncology, and urology here at Johns Hopkins. And I think I would agree a little bit with Dr. Wood. I think that in the future we're going to take a look at patients' cancers. And we find, actually, that some cancers are already being recognized fairly highly by the immune system, especially in cancers like bladder and kidney cancer and lung cancer, melanoma. And for those patients, immunotherapy using the immune system against cancer will probably be a first-line treatment. And this is fortunate because what happens as cancer develops and as it's treated, it evolves. And within the body, there are not that many systems that can evolve. The nervous system and the immune system are the two best examples. Some patients, though, we're going to find out that their tumors look like they're not going to readily respond to the immune system. And there, what's going to be important is thinking of combinations using either radiation therapy, conventional therapies, along with immunotherapy to try to get a response that can be durable. And in some of these patients, these responses have been incredibly durable, and it's very satisfying when you see that happen.
So next we have Ted DeWeese. One thing that's remarkable is radiation therapy has been a mainstay for the treatment of cancer, particularly the early cures of many cancers, since we thought about treating cancer all the way back to Marie Curie and before. The technology drivers enabling fields for radiation to be crafted have been stunning. The ambitions of radiation oncologists building these nano tools with Swiss Army knife kind of theranostics. Where are we headed in this, Ted?
Well, thank you, Bill. First, if I might, exactly 363 days ago in this room, I had the great pleasure of spending time with Mr. and Mrs. Kimmel and many of the other people in this room when I had the great fortune to be installed as the inaugural Sidney Kimmel Professor. So that was such a fabulous time, so thank you for that.
That puts the pressure on you for this future exam.
It really does, absolutely. So I'll point out two things, Bill. One of which is what Chuck Drake just described, because radiation therapy, if you think about it, unlike drugs, where drugs kill cells, but they kill sort of percents of cells, fractions of cells. Radiation therapy tends to kill logs of cells, many, many tens of thousands of cells, which is great when you're thinking about the local tumor, but how would one make radiation a systemic treatment? How do you integrate that? And Chuck described one of those, which is the exploitation of radiation's killing of these cells, the presentation of dead cells to the immune system, which might drive systemic responses. So that's very cool. But in reflection of Bill's question, there are ways to take small little molecules, whether they're nanoparticles as they're termed, or I see my pal Sean Leupold here, little pieces of RNA that are the most highly specific, most tightly binding to any target that you would like. And then if you can target that specifically with a piece of radiation on it, remember radiation kills a lot of cells, and there are certain types of radiation that kill even better. I always like to describe it as standard radiation is like throwing a few bowling balls into the room, and you know you're going to hit a few people and then hurt a few people. Some of the kind of radiation we use is like driving a Mack truck through this room. It's going to kill a lot, and we can target that these days with these little particles, so you can kill a ton of cells very specifically. And Bill, the other thing I'd like to mention, just because I think it's so different from perhaps what we might talk about later, the other bit of the future, I think, and we talk about personalized medicine, and when we think about that or individualized medicine, oftentimes we think about that as the DNA gets out of this patient's sequence, so we know what mutation, et cetera, et cetera. Extremely important how we might use that to decide what drug or what dose of radiation to give. However, the other piece of this is there are these big, very sophisticated so-called data warehouses where there are all the patient-specific parameters embedded in it. So the history, the physical exam, the imaging studies, the laboratory studies, the genetic pieces of information with structured data from all of their outcome and other pieces of unstructured data that says, well, what were their side effects like? And we have actually built this in a little domain in radiation oncology around head and neck cancers where you could be anywhere in the world, you collect those data, you send it in into the system, it quickly analyzes the treatment plan of the radiation that you've devised in Dubuque, Iowa. It says, yes or no, that's likely to receive the outcome that you have predicted. More than that, it tells you if it's not as good as it could be, how would you fix it to be better than it is? And more than that, what's the likelihood of a side effect? So that's been deployed here. That's been deployed at other places in the U.S. and about to be in Canada and Japan. And so the world, world of oncology is going to change when we don't just have all the patients of Johns Hopkins in this database. We don't just have the patients within these other institutions, but you have patients across the country. Now you have millions of patients to reflect your own individual patient against and say that's the best treatment, or no, maybe the other one is. So I think, Bill, that's an important piece of the future that we have actually finally developed.
So then Ken Kinsler, who I see in the back, our new associate director for basic science, Ken and I were graduate students together, and I think it's fair to say in our vintage, if you could isolate a single gene and try and figure out its sequence and have any thought of what it did, you would have been quite famous in our vintage. Now that's really quite passe. In fact, it's so boring, I'm not sure you could publish a result like that. And that's because of technology. And you can't have technology without gearhead thinking people. And Boston, where is genomic technology going?
Thanks, Bill. I am one of those gearheads, yes. My name is Srini Vasan Yagnasubramanian, and if that's a mouthful, I go by Vasan. It's a lot easier to say. I have the enviable task of being at the end of this panel, so rather than repeat a lot of things, maybe I can just say a couple of perspectives that are a little bit from the technology standpoint. I think a lot of the problems that we're facing can hopefully be addressed by a convergence of technologies across many, many different domains, so that if we can really harness that and then try to solve those problems and inform our policymakers in such a way that they can make informed decisions rather than arbitrary ones, we'd all be a little bit better off. And some of the technologies that Bill has described are really revolutionizing the way that we can address and tackle these problems. Some of them include things like sequencing, and as Ted pointed out, there's huge information science in terms of the breadth of information across populations, patient populations, et cetera. But actually within each one of those people, there's an incredible depth of information that we can harness from technologies like this in terms of their sequencing, their physiology, other parameters of their body that we can collect data on. And so at the end of the day, it becomes this incredible information problem. So we need to think about how we can harness that information, use it to solve our problems, and to do that, the most amazing thing, and I think what's reflected in this panel and just looking across the way, it really requires a multidisciplinary team effort. And here in the Cancer Center, we really have that privilege to be working with the best minds in each of those disciplines, you know, from radiation oncology and cancer immunology and oncology, epidemiology, cell biology, pathology, and surgeons, combined with some of the best information science thinkers and computational biology, Sarah Whelan, Leslie Cope, I see here in the audience. I think we can come together in a way, maybe stimulated by technology, to really address and tackle these challenges and push them to the next level.
So one of the things that's most fun and most rewarding from the perspective of leadership, as you can imagine, to try and be director of a great cancer center like the Kimmel Cancer Center, I don't know if you figured this out, but you don't have to tell people what to do. Okay? They have plenty of ideas of what to do and where to go because they're going to build and shape the future. One of the things I find very rewarding is that what you see up here, look at this diversity in perspectives and the way the cancer problem is being approached. I think we have somebody approaching it from almost any direction, above, below, behind, looking at the guts of the cell, the guts of the genome, all the way up to the population scale. Magic occurs, I believe, when some of these people who don't think about one particular field or the methodology come together with another one. And Vasan was describing that this place is a great place for that kind of activity. And I honestly believe that's why people are attracted here. That's why we have Kimmel Scholars that fare successfully in a very vigorous competition that we have every year to award the grants. So what I was wondering is that for any of you, and perhaps more than one of you, what do you see completely outside your field that you think is going to change your field and the way you're going to do research and the questions you're going to ask in the coming future? Because you'll see it here. What from outside your field is going to change your field? I stumped him. See, that's when you can say, ah, he's still the boss.
All right. So from outside of my field, it's measurement. So it's exactly what Vasan does. So he's able to look across the entire genome at methylation. Methylation is critically important in regulating whether a gene is turned on or turned off, whether that gene is able ultimately to produce a protein or not. So in my field, I have people that I study. I can ask them what they're doing. I might be able to use a little bit of technology to measure their physical activity. But I come together with Vasan when we want to actually study molecular changes, in this case methylation patterns, in individuals. So we have a study that I think is quite interesting with one of our doctoral students. And by the way, that study came about because of our cancer center partnering with another university, Howard University. And this was a study where we wanted to start to understand why is it that black men have a much higher risk of prostate cancer than white men. And we wanted to look in the in utero environment. We wanted to see if there are differences very early in life that may account for these big differences in how aggressive the disease is and how different the rate of the disease is. And so we've now come together with Vasan, with a doctoral student and another faculty member, to try to look at differences in methylation patterns in the cord blood of these infants, so African American and white. We also look at differences across the moms, whether the moms have gained weight or not, which sounds like an odd thing to study, but you can imagine if the methylation patterns change in the fetus because of maternal weight gain, and that sets that child up for a different risk of cancer later in life, we need to know that. We need to understand the underlying molecular mechanisms that are occurring. So again, we have populations. In this case, these are moms and their babies. It's a study that we had done a number of years ago. We have the samples in our repository. And then we came together with Vasan and this doctoral student to pose a question about changes in methylation of genes that are known to be associated with obesity and cancer to see if we see changes in those genes related to race and related to maternal obesity. So it's quite powerful. We're at the very beginning of that type of research to be able to look across the entire genome, but he's got the technologies to measure. I wouldn't have had those technologies. And it takes both of these disciplines coming together to address such a question.
So Chuck, what's going to happen in cancer immunology? Are we going to be talking about the metabolism of T cells? Are we going to be thinking about the genetics of cancer? Where's the next big step going to come from?
So I think the next big step is going to be threefold, actually. So one thing is what you just mentioned is, I see my friend Jonathan Powell in the back is one of the world experts in metabolism of T cells. And it turns out that the immune cells that infiltrate cancer, the times they're not working, one of the reasons they're not working is because of their metabolism is altered. And Jonathan's lab has designed some drugs to address this. And what we've done is been able to profile some of those cells from different kinds of cancer, from bladder cancer, kidney cancer, and prostate cancer, again, in collaboration with our friend Vasan. So we have a very deep understanding of what the immune cells that infiltrate cancer look like. And some of those changes are clearly metabolic. Other of those changes, though, are things that we wouldn't have thought of as immunologists, and that's changes not in the genome, but in a layer on top of the genome known as the epigenome or epigenetics. And this is an area that Hopkins has great expertise with Steve Balin and with Vasan as well. And so another idea that we're working on in the immune system is that perhaps some of the responses are being blunted by not genetic changes, by epigenetic changes. And Vasan and I have a project to study that, particularly in prostate cancer. So those are the kind of collaborations and things that we're doing together that we would never do by ourselves, frankly.
I'll throw one out to Laura. Laura Wood, one of the things that has been impressive to me for a long time is we went through a process 30, 40 years ago. If somebody died while in the hospital, we might offer their family the possibility of undergoing an autopsy to try and figure out what happened. With the advent of CT scanning and MRI scanning, if somebody dies of a cancer, we kind of know what happened. That's not so much the question. But studying human tissues, biopsies, materials from autopsies, very small amounts of tissues, even things from the blood circulation that have the carcasses of cancer cells in them, we're trying to learn all kinds of stuff about human beings and their individual cancers. Where is that going to go?
I mean, I think pathology has a huge role to play because, you know, decades ago when studies were done on tumors, you just kind of took a hunk of a tumor and mashed it up and extracted DNA or extracted protein and then just studied it. And what we know now are that tumors are a mix of the cancer cells, the stroma, the immune cells. There's a huge number of cells in there. One of the important roles pathology plays is that we can actually say, you know, those cells are cancer, those cells aren't, so we want to study these cells that are cancer. You know, this knowledge of the tissue is also very important for being able to look at a slice of, you know, for me, pancreas, and say that's a precursor to pancreatic cancer. We want to analyze those 100 cells and get rid of the other 10,000 cells in this section.
The ability to see in detail what's going on inside a cell in unimaginable resolution, not just by fixing the cell and bombarding it with electrons and cutting it really thin. But to watch it actually do its business has been astounding. Where is that going? Are we going to be able to see every single thing a cell does?
Yeah, so for a long time, you know, I think the field is moving incredibly quickly with biophysicists now who are developing microscopes that can see objects that are separated by less than 200 nanometers in resolution. And so we're really empowered now by these new instruments that allow us to look and peer inside living cells and see things happening with exquisite detail that we were unable to observe before. And so we can get down to tens of nanometer resolution now. So that's not as high a resolution as
how
you could.
Small is that for really small?
That's, yeah. I mean, I think the other thing that's really changed that's been incredibly powerful is our ability to be able to manipulate the genome. So for a long time, we've been frustrated by looking at normal and abnormal cells and studying their properties. But what we really wanted to do was change the genetic content of these cells so that we could observe how those specific manipulations change the physiology of those cells. And now with technology that's really come from discoveries in the basic sciences, trying to understand how bacteria are able to evade infections from viruses, there's technologies that have come along that allowed us to alter the genome with exquisite specificity. And those are being incredibly powerful in the cell biology community.
So Ted, you've got to watch these fields grow as a leader in radiation oncology, not only here, but across the country and the world. Where is that? What's the next step that you see that's going to invade the mind of radiation oncologists to enable them to do even more remarkable things than they've done before? Where's that going to come from?
That's a good question. I was just thinking as you were speaking, I do think there's a place that has been talked about. In fact, many years ago, a student at Don Coffey, who's sitting in front of us here, had give a lecture, still hasn't been solved, and that is, why do cells of different types respond differently to radiation? They have the same DNA, exactly the same, same general structure. So why do they inherently respond differently? Why does an intestine cell, is it different than a skin cell, is different than a muscle cell? And the answer is, I don't really know the answer to that. Thank you, Bill. But one of the, and this comes from a cell biology, biomedical engineering perspective, Bill, which is it possible that the biomechanics of how those cells are organized, and I don't mean organized around sort of the ability for them to replicate, et cetera, it's literally the shape and the organization of those cells dictates how they respond. And I happen to think about radiation as the medicine, if you will, but it would be the same issue with respect to drugs that might be applied. And if we could understand how the structure actually influences how cells would respond, and maybe that explains some of the inherent differences, there are things we can do to manipulate the structure, the fundamental structure of how cells are organized, that could dramatically alter how cells might respond to a given stress, whether that was radiation stress or chemotherapeutic stress. The other place, which is more a little bit further out, which is this general notion that, and this is a bit hand-waved, but those of you know me know that's all I can do, that in many ways the cancer is an evolutionary process. It changes over time. It adapts to environments. It adapts to certain stresses. And from an evolutionary perspective, what are the things that wipe out species, historically speaking? Changes in temperature wipes out massive species. Change in pH, the acid base, could wipe out species. Ability to have the appropriate oxygen content can wipe out a whole species. So how does one adapt evolutionary biology and thinking into cancer therapies? And again, I'll look at our collective mentor, Don Coffey, who's been thinking about this a long time. And can you, with new technologies, change on a micro or nano scale, very tiny, Bill, nano means tiny, nanoscale, can you change the temperature of the environment such that the cells do not tolerate that stress well and therefore are primed to die to a next stress? And I think we've thought about that from a nanoparticle perspective. There's newer ways to think about it, Bill. And there are also mimetics. That is to say, you can develop drugs that make the cell believe it's at a different temperature from a DNA and RNA perspective, and then they become extremely sensitive. So I think it's those two places.
So Vasan, I'm not even going to allow you to speculate because as a genomic thinker, and you mentioned some of our information scientists that are in the audience, I see Leslie Cope there, Sarah Whalen, and the like. With the ability to sequence DNA, I'm going to ask you just a couple of engineering questions. How fast are we going to be able to sequence it? How much data are we generating now? Just how big, and you can use numbers and scale, how big is this problem becoming? What kind of computers are we going to need?
Yeah, this has been really interesting to watch as it's been unfolding, because basically everything that happens in terms of dimensions in the space is exceeding what we imagined it could do. In computer science, there's this law called Moore's Law that suggests that the technology to accelerate the power of a microprocessor will basically grow exponentially. And that's been being followed for many, many decades now. And if anything, there might be a little bit of outstripping that prediction for computer science and computer technologies. The sequencing world, where you can produce this kind of data with DNA sequencing, has also basically been able to do that in the last few decades from the origin of DNA sequencing. And if anything, it's actually outstripping the rate at which computer technology is going to be able to grow. And so there's going to be a point, not in the too far distant future, let's say actually even within a decade, where the degree to which we can generate sequencing data and information and generate other types of biological data will greatly outstrip our ability to store and process that with computing technology. And so we're going to have to make innovations in that realm to actually keep up. There have been some very provocative types of arguments that suggest, for instance, that at some point when we can make a generate sequence data at such a high pace and at such a low cost, maybe we shouldn't store the data. We just store the DNA sample and then resequence it when we need it, because it'll be more expensive to actually to store it otherwise. I'm not sure that that's going to be
the
solution.
So they had the Neanderthal guy. He stored his DNA for however long that was.
That's correct. That's correct. So as the technologies improves, so too will our ability to replace the need to store them by just redoing it. But the real challenge at hand now is, how can we do things while we really have to wait for innovations in computer science and information and science and computational biology? How can we sort of make those innovations to actually leverage all the information we're collecting now when it's at a population scale, and also the depth of each member in the population is equal to the width and breadth across the entire population? That makes a very large challenge and problem that we need to tackle. And so I think major innovations there are going to really push the envelope in terms of how quickly we can make advancements.
So you guys are hearing just how exciting the future is going to be from people who are going to create it. And I have to say, watching them, these are the people who stay late at night here, who are restlessly wondering what they're going to do next. And so in the form of a final thought, I'd like to ask each one of you, start with Vasan and go down the road. What is the number one question today that keeps you up at night, not in a bad way, but you're so excited you can't wait to answer? What's the number one question that you think of today?
So I think for me it comes in this form specifically, because this is where I work a lot in terms of thinking about prostate cancer, but I think somewhat more generically as well. We're trying to think about how we can fill unmet clinical needs. And I think one of the ones was mentioned earlier. One is a need for getting better biomarkers, ways that we can test individuals to figure out that they have aggressive forms of prostate cancer and intervene early for such people so that they don't have to suffer with late stage disease. And the reality is that even if we can get pretty good at doing that, there will still be some folks that actually escape that and then develop late stage disease. And for such individuals, our options right now are somewhat limited, because the success of things like surgery and radiation oncology to control disease at the primary stage when it's still localized is not as successful when it's advanced and in late stage disease. And although there's been major innovations in having things like targeted therapy to have low toxicity and have very good efficacy in terms of controlling disease, what we're finding is that cancers are very wily creatures, and they can evade those responses by altering their physiology, if you will. And so I think a major challenge that we're going to face in the years to come is how to think about combination therapies, just like we have in HIV and actually in classical cancer chemotherapy, where we can come up with very effective combination therapies that will not only treat the initial disease, but then actually avoid the resistance that can emerge and help patients. So a lot of what we think about in the lab are to use an emerging discipline that multiple people have talked about, a discipline of epigenetics, to think about both of these processes as a source of biomarkers to actually allow both diagnosis and risk stratification of disease, but then also as a mechanism by which cancer cells might evade therapeutic strategies, and then to take advantage of that to treat cancers at the advanced stage as well.
So Ted, awake at night, what are you thinking about?
That's for other reasons I'm awake at night, Bill, but so.
Probably because I called you or something.
Probably. I'll be very brief. I think one thing we have to focus on, we treat patients well, but there's the obverse of a coin. We can hurt people with what we do. And the issue is, how is it that you know who needs what dose for their particular situation? And this is something that Voss and I actually have been working on. Can you individualize the therapy more? And I really, that term kind of gets lost in the shuffle sometimes because it's not focused. It really is about trying to provide the correct treatment and not hurt patients. Because there's patients that I know I treat who don't need as much radiation as I give them. I just don't know. So I treat everybody in some sort of general pool, some of whom need more therapy and some of whom need less. And this, in my domain of radiation oncology, this radiation signature is something I believe we can find. And there's some techniques I won't bore you with today, but that keeps me up at night knowing that I am over-treating some patients and I can hurt them and they don't need it.
So Chuck Reich worked so hard, I'm not sure he ever sleeps, so awake at night isn't really the question. But what's the thing you can't wait to ask tomorrow?
Yeah, I got to tell you, so we were fortunate at Hopkins to be able to treat some of the earliest patients with drugs that activate the immune system, particularly a molecule called anti-PD-1 that started in 2007. And you know, last week in clinic, I saw two patients from that first trial who are still alive. And it's just amazing. They're in complete responses. But unfortunately, there are many patients on those trials who are not still alive. And knowing why those patients are still alive and the other patients are not, what was different about their cancer and their immune system, is something I think about all the time.
Elizabeth?
Okay, so lots of things keep me up at night. So first is measurement. So Vasan, you talked about measurement of the outcome, right? Being able to classify men, for example, with respect to how aggressive their prostate cancer is. I worry about measurement of exposure, right? To be able to classify individuals, people, with respect to their exposures so that we can figure out what actually is causing cancer at a population level. We know some of the big ones, smoking, obesity, inactivity, but they together explain only, or you can say it's a lot, depending on your perspective, 50% of cancers in a population. So I want to figure out what are the other 50%, okay? We need better measurement. So that's with my scientist etiology hat on. When I have my cancer control public health hat on, what keeps me up at night is we have been unable to translate what we've learned about prevention into really making profound differences. Now, smoking we have done a lot for. Obviously, our rates of lung cancer have come way down because we've had effective ways of intervening at a population level, right, a societal level. But there's so many other areas where we haven't had great strides. For example, in weight loss. And so figuring out a way to actually make a difference through behavior changing, understanding communications better, all the population science disciplines working together to actually make differences in populations to reduce the risk of cancer, and also to create healthier survivorship. So in those who are diagnosed, beyond treatment, what can we do to ensure not just that the cancer won't come back, but to ensure that individuals have the optimal well-being as they move through the rest of their lives?
So Andrew Holland, I know it keeps him up at night because he's just become a father. But while you're burping the baby, what are you thinking about?
So I think one of the things that always I find remarkable when we look at single cells is how much variation and noise there is from one individual cell to another. We look at them and we treat them all the same in tissues, in culture. We think that these are all identical. And at the genetic level, they may be, but at the levels of the proteins and gene expression, they vary dramatically. And what's truly remarkable is that the systems are so robust and that these cells behave usually in a homogeneous fashion despite all this noise and variation that exists. And so I tried to think about that in my research, how robustness is built into a system that's so inherently noisy. And we're also really interested in whether that systems level actually plays into the resistance that we see so often in cancers, because these are living entities and the cells are able to adapt and find mechanisms to be able to survive in response to very strong selective environments. And that ultimately underlies a lot of the resistance that we see in cancer therapy, and we'd like to try to understand more how cells respond as a system.
There are precancerous lesions that are low risk and they're very, very common. And then there are precancerous lesions that are high risk and uncommon. And what you want to do is you want to identify those people who have the high risk ones that are uncommon and not the ones with the low risk that are common, because there's a huge risk for overtreatment depending on what your intervention is. Like for the pancreas, it's a big surgery. So you only want to treat the people who are very likely to progress to invasive cancer. And I think finding markers that distinguish those people from who have the common low-risk precursors from the ones that have the uncommon high-risk precursors is a huge issue, because you want to get people before they get cancer, but you don't want to identify 70% of the population that is at very low risk. And then the second one relates to our discussion about genomics and kind of big data. And certainly the generation and the storage of the data is a huge issue that we haven't solved yet. But then what do you do with that data once you have it, even if you can store it? You know, you do a whole exome sequencing or whole genome sequencing, you get lists of hundreds, if not thousands, of variants, and a lot of them we don't know what they mean. So you have this list, even if it's well-analyzed, well-curated data, you don't know which of those variants really matter. And I think there's a huge need to better understand how genes interact with each other, how they form into pathways, and to actually know which of the mutations are important and which are actually just passengers that are accumulating. So we need new model systems to test the importance of mutations. We need new, you know, in silico algorithms to try to figure out which are the mutations that matter and which are the ones that are just along for the ride.
So, you know, pretty much every day that I come here, and I think almost everybody walks through the doors of the Kimmel Cancer Center, you can honestly say you just wonder where the next breakthrough is going to come from. You've seen a glimpse of what is ongoing here, what's going to be in the future. The only thing that's certain is that it's going to come, and it's likely to come here. So let's thank all the panelists. And we can let you grab a seat, because you'll want to watch the what we have in store next. And as they get to their seats, one of the things that I would love to do is, and it's the funnest thing I get to do today, is to welcome Sidney Kimmel to the podium. He's the greatest cancer philanthropist everywhere. That's why we have his name.
When I was active in the apparel business, there were dozens of cost factors I examined daily to determine the wisdom of proceeding with this design or that dress. But in the end, the measure of its success was always, what's the return on investment? Some say I did well in the schmata business, and while I cannot argue, I think my return on investment is even better here. Would we all be sitting here today if I had not made my gift in 2001? Likely I would not, but many of you would. What's unknown is whether the Cancer Center would have come as far as it has, as creatively as it has over the last 14 years. Bets are made where there's a track record of success and where there's a history of giving. Excellence in philanthropy is measured by results, not good intentions. Thus, I'd like to think that some of the growth occurring here has followed our lead. There's been a huge growth in real estate, the latest evidence of which is a groundbreaking for the Vera Building in September. Clinical demand seems limitless. Research funding is always under pressure, but Hopkins has received its fair share, if not much more, And there is a magnetic attraction for what has become an unbelievable body of people who really are the cancer center, breaking new ground. And I think most importantly, regenerating itself with talented researchers and clinicians, and a notable anticipation of the future with wonderful young leadership. I think we can all agree that has been one hell of an investment. And while we all recognize the enormity of the challenge of cancer, one cannot come to Johns Hopkins and walk away thinking anything other than the greatest opportunities are located right here. I've said this often, but it bears repetition. Caroline and I love coming to Hopkins. You've got it right in every which way. We know it, we see it, and we take good feelings from it from wherever we go. So while it can always be a bit of a contest as to who thanks who more, let me be definitive. We are very grateful. Very grateful, proud, humbled to be associated with Hopkins Medicine, the Cancer Center, and the very many people who make this the best there is. Thank you for being here today, and again, a very special thank you to those who planned today's events and participated in this exceptional panel discussion. Thank you very much.
So all of us are fortunate, many of us very fortunate, to have a chance to see Sidney, hear his thoughts, hear what the intentions, the logic behind someone who wants to change the world for people with cancer, how he thinks about it, how he views philanthropy as an investment to generate results. But what I find, and Ted DeWisa and I have talked about this many times, is there's a portrait of Sidney Kimmel that I actually walk by every day on the way into my office. And it is in the area where patients come from all over the world for cancer treatment. And many of them stand and ponder that portrait, recognize that it's Sidney Kimmel, figure out the connection to the name of the place, and say, they'll ask us, who is Sidney? Why did he do this? Why did he think that this was the thing he wanted to do? And we were very fortunate in some of our educational materials that we've created with the help of Lori Singer and her team, particularly Tim Bloomquist and Mike Vogel. They've prepared some wonderful videos for us related to patient education and patient experience. We've actually won the Telly Awards, and they're really cool. They look just like an Oscar. They let me keep one of them in the office. They do look just like an Oscar. We asked, and the Kimmels gratefully agreed, to capture Sidney's thoughts in his own words. And it's a marvelous little video. It's a real treat to be able to see it. So, Lori, take it away.
My life story as a youngster is no different than many other youngsters, because I wasn't the only one, my family wasn't the only one suffering during the Depression years. I remember earlier on when I was 2 or 3 years old, I remember being awakened 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning several times by my mother, who would say, we have to get dressed, and get up, get dressed in a hurry. I found out later on that's because we could beat the rent. My mother took great pains to make me look prosperous. And how she put a meal together 3 times a day was a miracle. Many times I have my lunch would be a ketchup sandwich between 2 pieces of sliced white bread. By the time I was 4 or 5, I realized that the next kid had a nicer sweater than I did, or a new pair of shoes, and I never had new shoes. I used to get hand-me-downs with holes in the soles. My mother would put cardboard in it to prevent it from seeping into my feet. I never felt that I was any different than the other kid. My father had been a successful band leader, sort of society bands, and when the Depression hit, no one was hiring any kind of bands. There were no weddings, bar mitzvahs, and celebrations. So my father was out of work. My father, unfortunately, never recovered from that. By the time I was 15, I was earning more money than my dad, which then I realized how terrible that was. How did my dad feel that his 15-year-old kid was bringing in more money than he was into the house? He virtually was penniless. He had no income. Eventually, he got a job as a cab driver, part-time cab driver. And by that time, I was in my teens, and I was aware, well aware of the financial situation in our family. But my father would come home at 6 o'clock in the morning after driving all night, come into the room, and he would hang his trousers up on a nail and then go to sleep. My mother would wake me up shortly after to go to school, to get me ready to school, and we would together empty out my dad's pockets, which was full of change. My father would bring home tip money, pennies, nickels, dimes, quarters. That was generally the rule. One day, my father got a $50 tip, and later on he told me the man was drunk, so he gave him $50, thought it was five. $50 bills, I'd never seen one, they were rare. And my father gave a fellow cab driver $25. He split it with him. And when he came home and told my mother was ready to kill him. How could you do that? And my father explained that this poor guy, he had three kids, he needed some money. And I can't tell you, some psychologist might explain to me that that's where I got the seed. My first job was in a bowling alley setting up pins. This was before the electronic pin setter. Then I was working for a jeweler, running pieces of jewelry and down to the jeweler's market every day. And then I got a job in a department store working, I was a stock boy in a Snellenberg's department store in Philadelphia. I couldn't wait to get out of high school. I was a top student from the year 1 to 11. And my 12th year, well, I just bided my time. I was a lame duck student. I just couldn't wait to get out because I wanted to get a job and make some money. I had no aspirations to go to college. I really never knew what I actually was going to do with my life until I was about 28 years old. My sole motive in life was to earn a living. I wanted to be able to help my family, and that was the motivation, to help my family, because my father never recovered from the Depression years. My mother, as a consequence, suffered from it. And I just knew that I was able to, and I should, and I was an obligation. I had no pressure from my parents, but I was started to make some money, and that's what I did. So I applied for a job one morning to a local manufacturer of large-size women's sportswear. And when I walked in to apply for the job, there were about 50, 60 young men ahead of me waiting. And I almost walked out of the room. I think, well, I haven't got a chance here. And this woman who was doing the interviews somehow caught my eye, or I caught her eye. And she said, "You wait here." And she, one by one, she got rid of the 50 or 60 guys. And she came over to me and said, asked my name. Told her, she hired me. So as it turned out, that was my entree to the women's sportswear business. And about a year later, my boss gave me an opportunity to become a salesman. I was a terrible salesman, by the way. I hated it. I traveled on the road for 7 weeks,
And I was a lonely young man, and I didn't like traveling, selling these clothes. But I stuck it out, and I brought back a few orders. And that was the start of it. It wasn't until later on that I realized that I had developed an aptitude and an eye for women's clothes. Before that, I had spent 9 years with a company that was established called The Villager. And that's where I really learned the ropes. My dream was to one day own my own company. So in 1970, I started my own company in a label that I called Jones New York. And I eventually built it into a $4.5 billion company. Well, you stop and think about it. If I had gone to school for 4 years, I would never have gotten the education at college than I got from actually being in the field, in the factories, and in the fitting rooms, and developing groups of clothes. I worked hard. I was determined to make a living. That was my drive. And my parents were still alive then, and I wanted to see them have a better life. They couldn't understand how I was making a living. They had a sense that I was doing well because I would give them money every week. And I learned later on, of course, that they didn't have to handle money anyway. My mother, when she passed away, she had like $132 in a special saving account, and she left it to me. That's something, right? She thought of me. Hooray for Hollywood. Well, I was actually doing Hollywood while I was still in the garment business. My first two movies were back in 1983 and 84. And I had two big hits, and I got hooked. I'm a better editor of ladies' clothing than I am of scripts. It is indeed a challenge, as the apparel business was a challenge. But it's my golf game, and I enjoy doing it.
Your philanthropy is what makes cancer a curable disease. Sidney, please join us up here. Give us a remark.
The word philanthropy was just, if you asked me what to define that, I wouldn't have known what the word meant during those early days. But I was never a dreamer. I dreamed of making a living, if you want to call that a dreamer. I was a doer. I had to do, I had to make it up in the morning and make a living. I didn't really get wealthy until I was 60, 61. A lot of guys inherit their money, and other guys make it when they're 30s and 40s. I didn't make any money until I was 60. Then I learned if you make money, the more money you make, the more money you can give away. My first venture into giving was in 1996. I believe one of my first ventures was to establish a cancer center in Philadelphia, my hometown, and I gave them a gift to set up what is known as the Kimmel Cancer Center in Philadelphia. This was at Jefferson. And shortly after that, I was invited to become chairman of a drive of a march on Washington to get Congress to enhance the budget for cancer research. And I gave them a substantial gift. I think it was $3 million.
We are on the edge of so many breakthroughs, so close to finally finding the answers that have eluded the cancer research community for generations. But medical research takes more than dedicated researchers. It takes money.
And people used to ask me, why cancer? My best man, Dick Gutierrez's daughter, eventually died at the age of 24. And that's what urged me to go into cancer research in a bigger way. Why Hopkins? Well, Hopkins has already been established as the number one hospital in the country and number three in cancer. I picked up the phone, and a week later, some Hopkins people came down to see me in New York, and I let them talk me into giving them a gift. I didn't need much convincing to say this is a place for me that I can call it home. And even though it's not my Philadelphia home, it's a second home in a way. So that's why Hopkins. I was joining the big league, so to speak. You know, when you give money to an institution or a hospital like that, you can't lay out what you expect. You expect the cure, an overnight cure for cancer. you're never going to get it. Hopefully, one day it will become just another chronic disease, which can be controlled. 17 years ago, we established the thing that we call the Kimmel Scholars. I have a great group of great board members. I mean, this is the creme de la creme of cancer researchers. It wasn't my idea originally. I embraced it immediately, knowing that what I was doing was helping young postdocs.
Pleasure to meet you.
Oh, Andy, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Just getting out of school and didn't have enough money to set up their own lab. And yet these were the young people who were depending on to one day make cancer a chronic disease.
What it does is all the information is here inside the nucleus and it can...
So each year we give 15 candidates $200,000, which represents to me a $3 million gift each year to the Kimmel Scholars. And that's what I do. I love doing it. Caroline will surely follow through with it.
The philanthropy is something that I've been watching Sidney implement over the last years, and it's taught me a great deal about giving and the responsibility that comes with wealth. I'm basically witnessing greatness, and I know that sometimes it brings me to tears, not because of the quantity, but because of the depth of his humanity. I feel the Kimmel Scholars is going to really be the big legacy, because so many people are going to benefit from the scholars and their level of knowledge and what they bring to the table. And I really feel that this is the future, and that's the future of this philanthropy.
One of my earliest Kimmel Scholars was a woman named Linda Lau, who's presently heading up the Brain Cancer Center at UCLA. 6 or 7 years later, after I gave her her gift, she saved a friend's life of mine. She performed a successful brain operation on a man who was going to die, and he's still alive today. So that's already worth all the money. You save a friend's life. No greater gift. And I'm grateful for been lucky enough, and that word is a very important part of my success, luck. Luck and hard work. Anybody tells you they weren't lucky, they're not being truthful. And I got lucky. When I first walked in and saw that my name on that building, I thought about my dad. And that's what I thought about. He couldn't have ever imagined that he could see his son's name on a building of this importance. So I think about him as, in a way, as a sad figure, but with a good heart, a twinkle in his eye, and a very generous person. He gave it his all. To this day, I feel that I was blessed with good parents. The fact that my father could give away half of $50 at a time when we were desperate to put food on the table, it indicated what kind of guy he was. And I guess that's where I got it. I don't know. I think all of us have certain responsibilities in life. Mine is to help others.
Sidney and Caroline, I want to personally, and all of us do, thank you for sharing your generosity, but also for sharing a little intimate look into how you think and the kind of life you've led. It's an inspiration to all of us, and so great to have you in Baltimore. So one more for Sidney Kimmel. Please join us for a reception.
And if you should survive to 105, look at all you'll derive out of being alive. And here is the best part, you have a head start if you are among the very young.